Now we noted that God forgives. Forgives so fully that David escapes death and brings joy to his soul. But there are consequences. I cannot tell you that if you come clean of your sin, your wife won't leave you. I cannot tell you that your kids won't hate you, that your boss won't fire you, the government won't arrest you. I cannot make you that promise. God often allows dark consequences to follow our sins. You may lose everything, but you'll have God.
More than anything else, God wants to control our minds this morning. You see, if God controls our minds, He has our bodies. If God controls our minds, He has our appetites. If God controls our minds this morning, He has our time. If God controls our minds this morning, He has our finances. Right down the line, it all comes back that the prize of control is of the mind.
I have not been treated as my sins deserve. And you have not been treated, believer, as your sins deserve. Perhaps you have confessed some secret sin sometime in the past, and the discipline has stayed. God was being merciful to you.
And God says, everything else are the scraps. I want your mind. I want your mind focused entirely with your affections and desires toward me.
And he says, whereunto shall we liken the kingdom of God? Or with what comparison shall we compare it? It is like a grain of mustard seed, which when it is sown in the earth is less than all the seeds that be in the earth. But when it is sown, it groweth up, and becometh greater than all herbs, and shooteth out great branches, so that the fowls of the air may lodge under the shadow of it.
So the scriptures tell us that the one who gets your mind gets it all. Your mind is the prize. And so the battlefield this morning is for our minds, and Satan is seeking to steal, to divert, to distract the minds of God's people away from God. But sadly, it seems that Satan has caught so many believers off guard. While they carefully avoid the obvious dangers and evils, perhaps the most powerful and the most deadly of the mind robbers has been overlooked. And what we see today is Satan neutralizing the power of a godly mind a little bit every day. How? Through the onslaught of the inescapable media in which we in our world today are immersed. And this morning, I'd like to talk to you about the world which flows around us like a raging, flooded river every day. I wonder, first of all, has it troubled you yet that our modern media has totally reset what is morally acceptable? In other words, the moral acceptability threshold has moved. It's been reset by the media around us.
And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and scribes and be killed and after 3 days rise again. And he spake that saying openly, and Peter took him and began to rebuke him. But when he had turned about and looked on his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, Get thee behind me, Satan, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. And when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels.
The moral drift in our culture of America and the world is important to understand because it's continuing unabated. Now, we already know how it ends. Revelation 9 says that when Christ comes back at the climax of the tribulation, it says that people are totally given over to three things. They're totally given over to the occult, to immorality, and to materialism. Immorality. You can't sell a stick of gum or a toothbrush without attaching a pretty girl to it. And materialism. People make life or death decisions with dollar marks on them, not with God, with dollar marks. And if the zeros and the commas are enough, they'll change their lifestyle and do it for the money. Not only has it troubled you that the moral acceptability threshold has moved, has it troubled you yet that the modern media has reset what shocks us? In the past, if we saw blood killing or tragedies on the evening news, it would disturb us for weeks. And now, it's nothing. Death is nothing. It's the rule of the newsroom. If it bleeds, it leads, is what newscasters say. And movies are worse. Beginning about 30 years ago in the 70s, succeeding waves of movies began to rely more and more on violence in order to attract a crowd. Audiences became numb to the repulsiveness as each level of violence ratcheted upward, so the directors have to keep enhancing the horror factor to maintain interest. And such has become common fare. And it doesn't seem to offend most people. Also, has it troubled you yet that God says in the book of Ezekiel that this is how he defines spiritual adultery? It is the sin of his people spending and investing more and more of their time, getting their help, getting their counsel, getting their direction, and getting their advice from sources other than him. He says, my people, they find their advice for their health, for their finances, for their lives, for their families. They find it everywhere but from me. Computer games, TV, movies, advertisements for Nike, Sony, Tommy Hilfiger, and Nintendo, and Adidas, and Gap, and Old Navy, and the World Wide Web. More by all that than by God's Word. God says, for his church, I want you to seek me first and my rule over every part of your life.
And he said unto them, verily I say unto you, that there be some of them that stand here which shall not taste of death till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power. And after 6 days, Jesus taketh with him Peter and James and John, and leadeth them up into an high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his raiment became shining, exceeding white as snow, so as no fuller on earth can white them. And there appeared unto them Elias with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter answered and said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here, and let us make three tabernacles, one for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Elias. For he wist not what to say, for they were sore afraid. And there was a cloud that overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud, saying, this is my beloved Son, hear him. And suddenly, when they had looked round about, they saw no man anymore, save Jesus only with themselves. And as they came down from the mountain, he charged them that they should tell no man what things they had seen till the Son of Man were risen from the dead. And they kept that saying with themselves, questioning one with another what the rising from the dead should mean. And he sat down and called the 12 and saith unto them, if any man desire to be first, the same shall be last of all and servant of all.
A shortened attention span? That means that someone who is a regular television watcher, according to Neil Postman, can't think about God very well. Why? Because it takes time to think about God. He says, you have to seek me with all your heart. The Psalms say you have to unite your heart. And so if I have to get my heart all united, and then I have to raise it up and focus on God, that takes time. And if I'm used to split-second graphics moving me along, that's what amusement is. Alpha privative on the word for meditate. Alpha privative means not. Muse, word for meditate. I do not meditate. Amusement means I don't have to think. I just am carried along. God says you have to think to know me. That's why he wants our mind. Secondly, if we have a reduced linguistic power, that means a regular television watcher can't talk about God very well. Boy, do we see that. Do you know what the biggest holdup to people joining our church is? They don't want to give their testimony. Their testimony is the greatest thing that you have. It is your declaration that God saved me and how he did it. Colossians 3, verses 1 through 17. If then you were raised with Christ, Paul says in verse 1 of chapter 3, seek those things which are above. So he says your whole orientation goes from living to stay in lockstep with below world living, and you change your orientation upward. You turn your satellite dish toward the satellite that's communicating with you. You set your attention, your affections upward. How do you do that? Well, look at verse 2. Set your mind on things above. Put on the new man, renewed in knowledge according to the image of him. How do you do that? Verse 12, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering. Verse 14, put on love. How do you do all this? Verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Dwell where? In your mind.